Good afternoon, my brothers and sisters in Christ. May the love of God, the peace of Christ, and the joy of the Holy Spirit abide in your hearts and in your homes. While it is a cloudy day, as I could see as I look outside, and I have been outside, I went for my little walk. I try to get about 10,000 steps in every day, if it's at all possible, and it's walking around the block of the church, or you may see me heading down Lexington. Those seem to be the least populated areas, and it allows me to move to one side of the street or the other if somebody is coming down my path. And it really is good to get outside and to get some fresh air and just to hear the sounds of nature, of, you know, God, and listen to the calls of the cardinals and the different birds and stuff. Just very uplifting in a time that we seem so confined. So I encourage you to, if at all possible, to get out and take a short walk or to go and just sit outside and enjoy. Sometimes there's a nice and pleasant breeze that comes by, and I find it's a great time to walk and pray, walk and kind of meditate on things. So just if you have that opportunity, I encourage you to go outside and to spend just a little time, if not a whole lot. In today, our reflection, if we look at the Gospel of Matthew, he's going now to the place, it's Matthew 26, where Judas Iscariot is going to betray him. So that is what is in the dialogue that is here, what is written for our lesson today, is that betrayal of Judas and him setting everything up, going to the Pharisees and receiving the gold coin, the 30 pieces of silver, those kinds of things. And then as I was reading this, I began to think about betrayal. And oftentimes in life, we come across that. We feel like we have been betrayed. Sometimes it is by our job, our work. We go to work someplace and we were told that, you know, oh gosh, you're the next one up in line, and then somebody gets the position before us and different things happen and we feel betrayed by that system, the work system. We can feel betrayed by the church in many situations. The priest wasn't there, this person wasn't there, I went by, it was closed. The bishop did this, the bishop did that, the priest did this, he said this. Yeah, so we can feel betrayed, in a sense, by the church. We can feel betrayed by the hierarchical structure of the church, where we feel like they've let us down because they're not doing things that we believe that they should be doing. We can feel betrayed by the school system. Teachers, we can feel betrayed by lawyers, other business people. We can be betrayed and feel betrayed by family members and friends. Even people that we have considered to be lifelong friends somehow may do something or say something, and we feel that they have betrayed the friendship. Jesus is familiar with betrayal. He's familiar with it. He knew that Judas Iscariot would out and out betray him. He even tells Peter, you know, before the cock crows, you're going to deny me three times. He has walked that path of betrayal. There he had done so much good. He had healed people. He had listened to them. He had cured them. He had driven demons out of them. And what do we do in return? Put him on a cross. The ultimate betrayal. So as we walk with Jesus to the cross, to the passion, maybe we need to start thinking about times when we have been the one who has betrayed a friendship, a family member, our employment, the church. It's easy to focus on being betrayed, it's harder to look at being the person who has done the betraying. And this is a wonderful time to cleanse. It's kind of like that deep cleansing that we can receive as we begin to move to Holy Thursday and then Friday. We've just experienced the Chrism Mass and the oils. And so we're into Holy Week. And today may be a good day to sit and think about, how have I betrayed Christ? How have I betrayed His church? How have I betrayed family members, friendships, my job? And then ask God to bring healing in. See, because if we can recognize these places where we have fallen short, it makes it so much easier when we seek God's forgiveness and His love, His grace and His mercy at our shortcomings, then we are able to truly forgive the shortcomings of others, because we have experienced that freedom, that feeling of love in having our own shortcomings forgiven, our own sins forgiven. So I would encourage you to perhaps use today before tomorrow, because tomorrow is the foot washing. Then this is a wonderful time to sit and read out of Scripture where Jesus washes the disciples' feet in the Gospel of John, and to kind of put into play and to sit and to do washing one another's feet, doing for others, washing away, allow Christ to wash away the hurt, the pain that you have experienced through betrayal, but also the fact that you may have betrayed someone or something. Great time to allow Christ to do some powerful, powerful work in our lives. The responsorial psalm really caught my eye. The whole thing is really a wonderful. It's dealing kind of with Christ in the sense of the anguish. It can be related to Him, but this is one verse that just really stuck out to me. And I thought, God, how marvelous is this verse? I will praise the name of God in song. I will glorify Him with thanksgiving. See, you lowly ones, and be glad. You who seek God, may your hearts revive, for the Lord hears the poor, and His own who are in bounds He spurns not. That is so awesome. As we enter into the passion of Christ, we have reason to praise God's name. We have such a great, great reason to praise His name. Because of the passion of Christ, all of our sins, all of them, have been forgiven. All of our shortcomings have been forgiven. All of the times when we miss the mark has been forgiven. All of our struggles, all of the things that we deal with have been forgiven. Let us not make this time a wasted time, but let us make this time a fruitful time. A fruitful time for us to grow in the grace and the knowledge of God. Just to send up prayers from time to time, oh Lord, I just want to thank you. Here I am, I want to thank you because in my past, these things really bothered me, and I'm bringing them to you now so that you can begin the healing. Lord, thank you for being forgiving to me. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for giving me the second chance. Help me, oh Lord, to give these individuals a second chance in my own life. Lord, thank you for always accepting me, allowing me to be the prodigal child that you receive in your arms. Help me to receive those who feel like they are prodigal sons and daughters, to bring them to the healing balm of your love. While we are separated, you know, we don't have to have a lot to remind us that we're separated. We are bound in Christ and in his love. We are bound in the joy of the Holy Spirit. We are bound in the peace that comes during this time. We have to but be open to it, to allow ourselves to experience the goodness and the grace and the love of God. Let us press on, my brothers and sisters. This is a wonderful week. Sometimes we can have the feeling it's Lent, it's Holy Week. We got to be somber. We've got to mourn. We don't. Because of the passion of this week, because of the end result of this week, which we will celebrate on Easter Sunday, the resurrection of Christ, we now can live the resurrected life. And we only enter into the passion that our own sorrows, our own heartaches, our own struggles can be united with Christ so that we can be healed and receive that sense of peace. When I talk about healing, it doesn't necessarily mean that all these things go away. What it means is that I am able to endure and live with a sense of peace in the midst of the storm, in the midst of the struggle. I feel his love. I feel his grace. I feel his mercy. I will praise the name of God in song. I will glorify him with thanksgiving. See, you lowly ones, be glad. You who seek God, may your hearts revive. For the Lord hears the poor, and his own who are in bonds he spurns not. He will not turn you away, my brothers and sisters. He will receive you with open arms. He will be glad to enter with you into your own particular passion. He will be glad to bring you into his passion and allow you to experience the healing that he can bring. These are not sad times. They're difficult times. For in the difficulty, our faith rises up and we are able to taste the sweetness of God's love and his care. Well, my brothers and sisters, until tomorrow, which remember, tomorrow is Holy Thursday, and we get to enter into the Triduum. Mark your times for any of the services that you, with the cathedral, or I'm hoping that they're able to do the Mass at Jesus the Good Shepherd at the appropriate time. They're trying to do the live feed and get that going so that we can experience it together as it's actually happening. My brothers and sisters, until tomorrow, peace. The blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.